Welcome to the Dividend Talk podcast, episode 55, a dive into some lesser discussed European stocks. Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of Dividend Talk. I'm your co-host European DGI, and today I'm joined with De Kleine Kapitalist. EMF is still on holiday on his well-deserved vacation, so I'm really glad to have another guest today. This is a podcast in which we discuss our passion for dividend growth investing with our own unique European flavor. If you are new to our channel, please hit the like button and subscribe to us. And also check out our previous episodes on YouTube and Spotify and all your other favorite platforms. See you on the inside. Hey, De Kleine Kapitalist, how great to have you on the show. How are you doing?
Great, great for having me. I'm De Kleine Kapitalist. I'm a blogger in Dutch, and I post about my purchases for over 3 years now, and I'm mainly a dividend growth investor.
Cool. Yeah. So, you know, you're part of also of the Dividend Day community and such. So we know we have met each other quite often and such. And I must say, I like your blog a lot. For the listeners, I will put this URL to the blog in the description of the podcast. And you mentioned justice in Dutch, but I can tell you just use Google Translate. There's really good stuff in there. And I'm really excited to have you today on the show, because for me, you're like an encyclopedia of also European stocks. And so I'm really excited. I know we'll be touching quite some interesting ones. So yeah, really cool to have you here. And but before we start, like have you has anything in the has it in the news caught your attention this week?
Yes, I one of the things that catched my eye was Siemens. They mentioned to accelerate their high growth strategy. I think Siemens is one of the better picks in the industrial European space. I really support their new strategy. It was good to read that one.
Yeah, it's really nice that you brought this up, because I'm a shareholder in Siemens. I've got some shares there, also some of their spin-offs. I thought it was Healthineers. We also discussed actually Siemens on one of our older podcasts together with EMF. And for me, this is like it has done everything well, what General Electric has failed on effectively. And I'm quite proud that we have such a European industrial company that actually was quite early in the movement of climate change, wind turbines, electric trains and such. Yeah, and that they want to even double down on this growth strategy is actually really nice to see, right? It speaks about some boldness, I think.
Yes, I envy your being a shareholder of Siemens, so maybe I will join you.
Well, welcome to the club once you decide to make a decision. there was something else great in the news as well. And for instance, the Trade Commission in the United States announced today that they are charging Broadcom with illegal monopolization here. It was hitting the news today. And I know you have some shares there. So I was thinking, like, and you know a lot about the chip industry as well. So I was really curious about your opinion on this one.
Yes. Broadcom is one of the more aggressive chip manufacturers to my eyes. They have an insane dividend growth. It's really working like a magnet on dividend growth investors. But this is, I feel, something about the risk-reward ratio. Mm-hmm. What is your perspective on this happening?
So, I had the other day, I think, even Broadcom on one of my watch lists. So I dove a little bit into it. And then one of my Twitter followers shared some articles with me about the aggressive style of management, where they typically buy companies, use that for also to fuel dividend growth, but also kind of kill almost the capex, milk it out, also having some really, really tough contracts with suppliers and such, where they're really using market manipulation effectively. That and I guess that's also where the story about monopolization to squeeze them out with such. So I think business-wise, ethically speaking, the CEO I think is really operating on the edge, but the financial performance has definitely been there. So from that point of view, if you're a shareholder, you could yeah, I can imagine that many people like this company from a dividend growth point of view. Ethically, it's really for me on the boundary. I could still own it from that point of view. I'm never so scared with monopolization because I see it actually as a recognition for a good business model. It's not easy also to split up a company. It doesn't happen so quickly. Such companies usually buy an army of diplomats as well. So for me, like Facebook and these kinds of companies, it's actually really good recognition. I think it should be almost every CEO's dream to build a monopoly, because it means because you cannot get there with poor products alone. Yeah. Once you're there, you might start creating poor products. That's the risk then. Yeah, that's my thoughts. Those are my thoughts about Broadcom.
Well, I really like your perspective, and also about that is a compliment for your business. But still, I'm happy to diversify. So I have more chip semiconductor stocks because I this kind of risks or can happen and can have detrimental effects upon the company.
Yeah, I think so. And I think most dividend growth investors have like easily 30, 40 stocks. So if you have one bad actor in it, it shouldn't really matter a lot unless the allocation is too high.
Yeah, I'm not worried.
No, but maybe there's also another interesting topic that you brought up before the show about the news, and you mentioned an article, a Dutch article about whether data as a source of truth is a myth. Right.
Yes. This is really one of my things which I really am keen on. When you know how data is produced and quite familiar with it, then you know it's just a model of the reality, and those are cached also in yearly reports, etc. And what I typically see in the community is that everyone is crunching the numbers and extrapolating and looking at all historical performances and, make a suggestion about the future. But I feel there's less attention for the fundamentals, the real drivers of the business, of how the company really works. I'm very aware about that data can bring a lot of value, but could also be harm you.
Yeah, and we exchanged some thoughts earlier about that, right? This also, I think, if you're also new to investing, it I think if you start reading books, it's easy to fall in this trap of looking at some of the performance, like 5-year growth rates and these kinds of things.
Exactly.
But it's really about, like, for me always, like, what's the catalyst for a company? Yeah, where is their growth going to come from the next 5 years? When it's possible for me, I always try to test their products, right? So like for Google, we can test their product. We can test YouTube. We can see so it's a really easy one. There are some companies that are harder to test, but sometimes you just need to go to YouTube or to other pages, to Amazon, to just read product reviews and to see how they are complaining or how they are cheering these products, right? So it's and this is nothing to do with data crunching. Yeah, it's all about getting a feeling for their company, for their products, how people perceive it. Yeah, good one. I think we could do a little bit less of this data crunching in the community. But it's so easy and so nice to play with data. So.
Yeah, it will give you a feeling of confidence.
Exactly. Okay. Well, thanks for bringing those news items. Very interesting. But let's go to the main topic of today. So today we will talk a little bit about lesser known European stocks, and we will be categorizing them to a few secular growth trends, which we see. Maybe a good disclaimer before that. These are not necessarily dividend growth companies. These are by definition more European stocks. Some of them pay a dividend, some not. So these are not like recommendations for necessarily for dividend investors, but these might be companies maybe interesting once they start paying a dividend and such, but they have some secular growth trends that we really want to call out today. So the Kleine Kapitalist, the first one where we have a secular growth trend is what we call the digitalization of literally everything, right? There's companies digital transformation. I mean, digital is everywhere. So what is the first company that you thought about regarding this trend?
Yeah, the first company that came to mind was Soitec. I hope I pronounce it correctly. It's a French company. And it's also because the general opinion is that in Europe there are not many technology stocks. Well, I think this is a hidden gem. They produce silicon on insulator wafers, substrates. So are they part in the semiconductor chain? And well, in pretty much every smartphone, there's one silicon part of Soitec. This company is really benefiting from the 5G trend. And well, the revenues will most is anticipated to grow to triple in 5 years. And what is also nice to know is they buy their wafers from Siltronic, which is a German company. So and the European tech companies are helping each other. Soitec is also without debt, and it looks pricey, but when you look at the growth, then actually it might not be that expensive, and it wouldn't surprise me if they will start to start with paying a dividend soon.
I didn't hear ever of this company before, and then you pointed me out as also a member of the 40 CAC CAC of the French index. And from what I've seen, it looks really, really solid. And specifically also since last year, you can see really the growth also in the share price here. So yeah, I can see it. I mean, I don't know how reliable the statistics are, but Yahoo Finance gives the price to earnings of 86. Yeah, so there's not a typical 20 price to earnings that dividend growth investors look for. But you know, at the same time, the share price also more than doubled just in a single year, right? And the growth just seems to be there. So market cap, I think, of 6 billion now, approximately.
Yes. The real moat is in that they produce wafers with less power consumption. So I feel, and this is the most sought after characteristic. So I think the growth rate is underestimated. So well, it's for growth investors, it's probably a nice one to look into.
Yeah, super. Okay. No, thank you. That was the first interesting one, totally out of my circle of competence, totally out of my comfort zone as a dividend growth investor. So, but hey, that's what I expected. Lots of these golden nuggets. I also know that as part of the, digitalization, you also came up with a teleperformance, which was a really interesting one in this context.
Yes, this one originated in one of the bigger problems that I see with large service companies. It's about customer service. You know, everyone is complaining about bad service, and this company offers solutions for interacting with your customers in also with call centers, digitization, analytics, etc. And they're really expanding. So I think it's a nice one to mention.
Yeah. But this is also not a small company, right? from that point of view.
No. It's really surprising that, from our community, we don't look at this kind of companies. Well, they are playing such an essential role for some of the bigger companies in the world.
Yeah. So what I noticed, they have like a 20 billion market cap at the moment, price to earnings ratio of slightly above 60. But also a dividend. They pay a dividend yield of 0.7%. So hey, that's the first one. So that's a good one. But again, share price almost doubled over a year. I think it is really in this trend now with many tech stocks and such that we're really, really benefiting from the pandemic. But even if you look at the 5 years price chart as such, you see like it's just a stable growth. It's not really volatile, this stock. So it seems to hit all the numbers here, but it also has almost 400,000 employees, which I was totally not aware of.
No, yeah, that's mainly because of the call centers, of course. But it's unbelievable that such a big company in number of employees you never heard about in.
Yeah, exactly. 400,000. I mean, that's a large city in Europe. I mean, not a capital, but it's a decent city. Yeah. Okay. So, and then the third one. What's the first stock in the digital of everything trend?
Yeah, the third one that I picked is called Avast Software. It's active in cybersecurity software. And originate in the Czech Republic. Well, of course, this is one of the bigger trends, and I think it's really a nice one when you want to have exposure in the cybersecurity sector.
Yeah. Yeah, I know Avast, of course, because I always got these pop-ups on my screen to install it when I bought a new laptop. It was typically packaged with a new laptop at the time and such. I used it a lot, and I believe they also acquired AVG Technologies at the time, also a product that I used. So I was really surprised when you came up with this stock. And also, this one pays quite a good dividend.
Yay! Yeah, it's above 2%, right?
Yeah, it's almost 2.4%. I checked the dividend policy. They have the typical dividend policy in Europe of paying around 40% of their, in this case, of their levered free cash flow. So as long as the company keeps growing, their dividends will probably also grow. But what I just like about this is that this is like an antivirus and cybersecurity software, where we are usually known with the American big tech companies, right? So to see this as a European company, a Czech multinational company, right, listed in the UK, is really cool that is on the list, and even a proper dividend of 2.4% almost, although the PE is still really juicy with more than 40. Yeah, nice one. So what I will do, by the way, for the listeners, I will put all the tickers and the ISIN codes later also in the description of this podcast, because we might not pronounce all the names well, or might go a little bit quick. So I'll put all the data in there so that you can later just go to the description and pick them up. Okay, so here we have three nice companies from digitalization trend. I think this is a secular growth trend that will still keep us earning money for the next 10 years from that point of view. The next trend that we have chosen is more like the aging population. And, you know, specifically in Europe, I think we're not making so many kids anymore as our ancestors were doing. So naturally, the population growth is a little bit stagnating, but people are also getting older at the moment, right? So I think this is also, again, if you look at the demographies in the big countries now, many people are retiring at this time around. I think well, I heard yesterday somewhere 50% of the population, I don't know, probably Netherlands, is more than 50 years old. So I think there's a really strong growth trend. And I'm curious to hear which kind of companies you're considering here.
Yeah, the first company that I considered was GN Store Nord. It's a Danish company, and they are active in hearing systems. And of course, when people are aging, you see many people with those hearing systems, and you know, they used to be very big, but now they are innovated, right? To, well, almost you cannot see them anymore. Mm-hmm. And this is one of the larger companies producing hearing systems. And the thing is that they were hit by the COVID pandemic. So they sold less hearing systems, but they also have a business in audio systems, and the home working well exploded. So they last year they had an organic growth of above 80%, which, wow. Yes, that's insane. While the hearing systems remain stable, so they're in total, they had an organic growth above 40%, which is great. And they pay a dividend.
Yeah. Well, the dividend is really small in this regard. It's, I think 0.26%. So it's a bit on the low end. I think it will take 50 years probably to get to a 10% yield on cost, unless they double it every year or so. Which might be possible, of course. It all depends on the growth and the future prospects. But yeah, I mean, these are the golden nuggets that we have in Europe, right? These kinds of companies, like it's really like, and this, by the way, huge company, yeah. But still, like these like equipments, and I think in Europe we anyway have a really good pharma industry, and this is also a bit fitting in there. But what is also nice, what you mentioned, is like, they are good in hearing aids, so for the aging population. But at the same time, they use this technology also for headsets and such, right? Here, so it's a nice way of being core to your technology, but then diversify in the consumer segments.
Yeah, and you really see it's working out because they level out those things with hearing and audio, yeah. And so they're quite resilient during this pandemic. Yeah.
And what are your expectations, that they continue on a high growth path, or do you feel like a price earnings of 45 is a little bit on the high end for this company?
Yes, it's on the high end for sure, but it could be typically so company which is always expensive and just keep on running. They have a natural tailwind with the aging population, and but also with digitization, home working. Yeah. So they have some good prospects, but it's richly valued.
And then the next one is a really nice one because it's a Noble 30 member, Coloplast. And then, yeah.
Yeah, it's also a Danish company. And it's in one of my favorite segments, medical devices. I really am bullish on MedTech. For the next 10 years, I will think they will do great. I have a couple of other stocks, not Coloplast yet. Mm-hmm. Well, also... doing it very, very, very well. It pays a dividend. I think it's 1.7%, and also have a nice dividend growth path.
Yeah. It's a Noble 30 member, right? So it has a minimum 22 years of dividend growth. I would need to look up the exact number, but I studied this company several times. And I'm amazed about the performance of this company, how it really turned from a really small company into a powerhouse at the moment. And it just doesn't seem to really stop. I mean, it's not anymore the high growth as it had in the past. So personally, I find the price to earnings of over 50, I find it way overvalued compared to how I see it in its future growth. So that's why the dividend yield is also on the low end, of course, with 1.7%. But this is such a company that always feels expensive. Though I must say, we're also in a really unique situation with low interest, right? So then these companies, I think, are also sometimes justified a little bit higher. But I'm not touching Coloplast at the moment. For me, it should almost halve before I get really interested. But maybe that's also my Dutch nature of being cheap. So, yeah.
Well, I'm also Dutch, and I want to say I'm also cheap, but I cannot do it with all those companies with PPEs above 50, right?
Yeah, exactly. Well, you know, sometimes we need to cheat on ourselves, right? Okay. And then there was also a third company, which is maybe not a lesser known to Europeans from their products and their brands, but many people, international people like from the States, don't know this company really. And it's EssilorLuxottica.
EssilorLuxottica, yeah, it's an Italian-French corporation, and it's headed in Paris. I think they are famous from their Ray-Ban glasses. And what you typically see at the aging population is that they need more glasses, right? I do not have glasses myself, but once I was in a store, I was surprised how expensive those are. So that's really triggered me. So to look into this company, and they also on an expansion strategy, right? So that mm-hmm. was in the news this week with the acquisition of Grand Vision.
Yeah.
So maybe we can briefly touch up on that news.
So this company, right, is also owned by one of the richest persons in Europe. And they made the acquisition of Grand Vision, and Grand Vision is a part of, I think it's called Hull Investments. And they actually ended up in court because of the pandemic, as I understood it. Grand Vision, of course, was severely impacted in the beginning. So what happened, I think, that EssilorLuxottica wanted to have a lower price for this company because the value changed, or the underlying value. They went to court, and I believe they even had something of a case, but in the end they decided still to pay the full amount of what they committed to Grand Vision in the end, because I also think they just noticed like how big of a brand this is also in the Netherlands. So yeah, it is expanding again via growth, and it will get now the whole Grand Vision part under this company, and I think it completes kind of the mission of the founder of EssilorLuxottica, as how he was envisioning this to be an empire. I think he has it now with this acquisition. So, also here, dividend yield 1.4%. A PE ratio is not realistic because we know that the earnings part was really bad in the pandemic. But I still find it overvalued compared to the fundamentals.
I agree on that. It's richly valued.
Yeah. Okay, and then maybe a little bridge to this, because we have a third trend, but you know, we'll just have one stock there, and it's a little bit cheating on it. But of course, we were talking just about a luxury brand and glasses. So there's also, of course, this Instagram generation, right? That all wants to look beautiful. And we know that L'Oreal benefits a lot from that. You brought up also a really nice story about Norwegian staple, actually. And you really surprised me about that in a very interesting way. Can you say a little bit more about this one?
Yeah, the company is called Orkla. And I choose that one because typically we always see the same consumer staples like Unilever, Nestle, Reckitt Benckiser, etc. So I thought, well, this is also quite a big company, and maybe you can know them from the toothpaste brand Jordan. But what I really like about this company is they're also in more the care products, so more like the L'Oreal touch, and also quite a good exposure to India. I always look at the geographic footprint from the revenues and really like large exposures to emerging markets. For the last 10 years, they have a total return of about 9%. It's really growing steadily, so it's a good pick for in your portfolio, and it's yielding above 3%.
Yeah, I noticed it, and actually, from what I heard you saying, I really, really like it, and I think many people that follow me know that I'm a big fan of consumer staples. So I really think I have one to look a little bit deeper into. And if you look at the five-year performance, it feels a little bit like it was dead money. Yeah, if you would have bought it 5 years ago towards now. You know, it allows nicely the dividends to accumulate and to grow into it. So I don't find it richly valued. It is trading slightly above 19 of a price to earnings. So it's, this one really attracts me. So thank you, Declining Capitalist, for bringing this one up.
Yes, I also want to mention another reason, because it's Norwegian. And I really like the exposure toward the Norwegian kroner. I think it's a strong
strong currency.
Currency, exactly. And also well, less affected by what we see with quantitative easing. So I think you can also have some good return from currency effects.
Yeah, really good one. Okay, cool. So, you know, you gave me 7 European stocks. Some of them I have never looked into, so thank you for that. I know why I've not looked into them ever, probably because they didn't pop up on my screener. But from the other end, Orkla and some of the others, I will definitely do some more homework there. I like, for instance, what you mentioned about also GN Store Nord. I believe also, I think you mentioned that before the show, of the Jabra equipment, and everyone likes Jabra. So there are really some good products in here that you shared with me today. So thanks for that. I'll look into it. Avast and Orkla will be the first two one for me. Hey, but also let's close with that out this section, the main topic of today, these 7 stocks. But let's go to listeners' questions. We have few again. I also know one specifically for you. So let's look into that. But the first one comes from, like always, from Phil Sackler, and he asks, would you buy shares of a football club? Example, Manchester United, Juventus, Borussia Dortmund, Ajax. Would you? What do you think about it?
No. Just a short answer. But I advised it once to a friend who was losing money on online betting. So I mentioned you could better buy a share of the football clubs that you bet your money on. So, yeah. But no, not for me. It's too unpredictable, more emotion, and like more in fashion. So no, not for me.
I have the same. I would never probably buy shares of a football club for exact same reasons. Thanks for asking, Phil, but no football clubs for us. And the next question is from Jilly, and he asks us, how do you guys create a watch list? What sources do you use?
Yes, a really nice question. It made me puzzling my mind, and the biggest origin is the real world. Just by walking, for example, I went to the office again. I walked to a gate from the railway, and I saw that name Thales on it, and that made me curious about the company. And it happens to be a French company, active on radar systems, defense, etc. It's a totally different company, and that's then I will I'll put it on my watch list and look if it could be a good pick for my portfolio. So that is a big source for me.
Yeah. And for me, I mean, I use the dividend screener. I have an article for that on my blog as well. I might put the link in the description. So I usually screen. I use what you say as well by keeping my eyes open into the environment. But in Poland, it is a little bit harder sometimes, because the most stocks I get only inspired by going to the supermarket. Because that's where you usually see the international products. But also just from listening to the community. I mean, today we discussed 7 stocks. There are 2 stocks that I will probably look into. So I get a lot of input from the community as well, and just on Twitter, keeping my eyes open to what people are saying. So that's how I usually then create my watch list. And I don't know if you have the same, but over time, if you look into a lot of stocks, then at a certain moment, you know, like 100 tickers approximately, probably with a price estimate or a price around it, you know, kind of what the yield was. So then if you see then somewhere in the news that the price was going down, that might also grab your attention again to quickly look into things.
Yeah, yeah, same for me. I also looking to patterns. So also by community, reading news, companies show up more and more often. And that is the time when I will look to read the most negative analyst report that I can access. But it's because it triggers you, right?
Yeah, yeah. Just to hear a different way of thinking and seeing. I do that also sometimes, then checking like, what is the bear case? And do I agree with it or not, right? And based on that, it makes it easier to add a stock to the watch list. Yeah. Okay, cool. Thanks, Jilly. Nice question. Then the next one is from Fire Pete. And he's this question to me. He said, in your spring cleanup, you sold Total, but you still have Shell. Is there any specific reason why you prefer Shell over Total? Well, to clarify that, I didn't own Total. There on my blog, there are 2 things. I have got a desired portfolio and I've got my real portfolio. What I did there is that I don't want Total anymore in my desired portfolio, but I will keep Shell in there. Why do I keep Shell in there? Just because I own a massive amount of Shell and I didn't own anything from Total yet. I actually see these companies as a little bit interchangeable. They are both pushed or via the strategy and the shareholders or via the government into more green, I said, investments. So I both fully agree with their strategy. I just wanted to lower my general exposure to energy and oil stocks. So I started to just limit, let's say, from 5 oil stocks to 3. And that's why Total didn't make the cut. Nothing specifically. If I would look at them both today, I would probably still go for Shell, because I would take, I would take into the consideration that they have less pressure from the cash flow on the dividends now. While I still think that, although they cut the dividend Shell last year, I still think that this is a dividend company by design. So I would probably still go for Shell. Okay, so then this question is from Richard, and this one is for you to answer, the Glenny Capitalist. And he's asking, what is your biggest conviction purchase recently and why?
Well, the first stock that came to my mind is Vonovia. It's a German real estate company, and I picked that one because I think it's it's a good hedge against inflation. The stock price went down because the fear of raising the interest rates, and they also acquired Deutsche Wohnen. What I really like about the company is that they offer affordable living spaces, which is another market than in the Netherlands, for example. It also pays a nice dividend, and they have a really nice double-digit growth. They have a nice expansion strategy, which have historically worked out very well for them. I really think this is a great pick, and I've wrote an extensive post about this company on my blog. So if you want to know more, I would.
I'll add the link to the description, and then I will recommend everyone to use Google Translate. It works pretty well from Dutch to English. So, yeah, nice one.
Thanks.
And that was also straight away, by the way, the stock pick for this week. So thank you for that as well. And thank you for triggering this question already, Richard. Okay. Next question is from Dividend Dane. And first of all, he he compliments us for being Dutch and not having a single cannabis stock in our portfolio. So the question actually is, do you really have no association to cannabis there? But you don't need to answer that. But anyway, what is real question is like, what is the one stock that got away from both of us? So a stock that we should have bought earlier, but never got on board, and now it's just too expensive.
Well, for me, one of the stocks that I really missed is L'Oreal. I really hate it to see it keeps on running. While I love the products, I love the secular trends which are behind them, and now it's so expensive. So that is the one that I really missed.
Yeah. Now, for me, it's Walmart. I remember there was a time that several years ago, 3 or 4 years ago, Walmart was trading around 4% dividend yield. And at that time, I don't know, there was a sentiment like Walmart would almost be dead. Yeah. And I should have bought then. I think it was like $60 or something like that at the time. I don't remember where it stands now. I only know that when the sentiment flew away from the market, it started just growing, and it never looked back. So, and they might even have done a stock split in between. So I really regret that one, because it was so open and out there. They're like, buy me, telling me. But I was still too early in my journey, I think, to spot such opportunities at that time. I was more sensitive to the sentiment than looking at the fundamentals at the time. Thanks, Dividend Dane. Good question. And yes, I don't own anything around cannabis indeed. I don't own tobacco stocks also anymore. So also no association to cannabis there. And I never smoke cannabis either. So maybe that is the reason why as well.
I don't either.
Exactly. We are so not Dutch, I guess. Anyway, the last question is from Danny from Poland, and he's asking me a little bit more about Dino SA. It's a grocery store in Poland, and it's rapidly increasing its presence in Poland. He mentions that it doesn't pay a dividend yet, but he's asking me for my opinion here. So, well, Danny, I looked into it. I must confess that I've never seen the shop, actually. The reason for that is when I looked up at their investor relations website is that it's mainly present in the west side of Poland. So I think there's less than 2 stores on 100,000 people in the region where I live. So I've checked them. I saw that one is like on 10 kilometers from me, so not in my reach. But their store growth is really, really, really impressive. I think they are growing by 10 to 20% in store count. So this is really like high growth. Also, if you look at how it is performing as a stock as well, it went from 2019 from 100, zloty, I guess, to 300. So it's a threefold in just 2.5 to 3 years. It's really impressive. And from what I've seen, it's all justified. I think you might be onto a really good stock here if you believe in growth investment. And to your point also, Danny, these are consumer staples like Ahold and such that at a certain moment when they mature will definitely start paying dividends, because that's what their cash flow will allow them to do. But now it's really in growth mode, so it's not for me. But it's really it's a really interesting stock. So thanks for sharing that with us in the community. Good. Now, the Kleine Kapitalist, we're coming here to the end of the show. It was really good having you on in here. We have discussed literally like 7 or 8 stocks today. We've never discussed on this show. So thank you so much for that.
Yeah, it's my pleasure. It was really great to discuss those stocks. I must say I was curious about your reaction, because they were really low yield, high growth types of stocks, and we had a discussion before. But I hope that you can also see that there are a lot of European stocks that are great quality in the low yield space.
Yeah, and I'm really happy that you brought this to the attention, because if you look at the blue chip companies in Europe, they all feel like a little bit being outcompeted by the American equivalents often, right? So, and here you really gave some golden nuggets of some niche industries where these are really like A players and top companies. So yeah, really good job. And yeah, I find in general all very expensive from a multiple point of view. But I also see this in the context of where we are with the current stock market, low interest environment, the economy. But yeah, definitely two ideas out of this. And the others, I might look a little bit more into it just to understand better the dynamics there. And maybe also that whether those are buy the dip companies. Good. Hey, thanks for having you here. Thanks for everyone listening. Let us know also what you thought about these stock mentions, let's say, because to be clear, these are not necessarily recommendations as such. Always do your own homework, of course. But everyone, have a good weekend. You too, the Kleine Kapitalist, and see you all next week again.